Over the last several weeks, I've been on an amazing journey through the life of David as I've been diving into his life, and I can hardly wait to take you guys with me on this journey. You might not realize it, but there is more material in the Bible about the life of David than anybody else except for Jesus Christ. That David is mentioned in 66 chapters of the Old Testament. They tell the narrative of his life. He's mentioned 59 times in the pages of the New Testament. Jesus is called the Son of God, but he's also called what? The Son of David. And David is born in the same city in which Christ is born. He's born in the backwoods of Bethlehem, and then he goes on to the city of Jerusalem, and he builds the city, and he lives in that city. But you know, David is really a paradox. He's really a mystery. There's an enigma about Jesus' life, because when you study the life of David, there are so many questions that are really difficult to understand. I mean, he's a ferocious warrior, but he also uses his skill as a musician to soothe the soul of Saul. He has the courage of Captain America, but he's really not a superhero at all, because he seems to fail as often as he succeeds. There are these shining moments in David's life, but then there are also these moments of shattering illusion and destruction. And one of the things in Scripture I've wrestled with the most about David is this phrase, a man after God's own heart. It's found, for example, in Acts 13, verse 22, where David is described as a man after God's own heart. And I began to really struggle with that because it seems like a contradiction. You've got this failure in David's life over and over again, and yet he's a man after God's own heart. How do you reconcile those two things? And I really couldn't find a way to bring those two things together, and so I did what every wise man does. I texted my wife, and I asked, Holly, help me figure this out. How do you bring these two together? And here's what she texted back. What I keep coming back to is grace. David sinned just like we do and even had seasons of sin. We like to categorize sin, so David committed the big ones, but God saw David's heart and it pleased him. God showed grace long before Jesus lived and died. It's encouraging that even though I sin constantly, God sees me as righteous, a person after his heart. Man, I thought she nailed it. She got it right. And then listen to these words from Max Lucado. He adds this. He says, one might read David's story and wonder what God saw in him. The fellow fell as often as he stood, stumbled as often as he conquered. He stared down Goliath, yet ogled at Bathsheba, defied God mockers in the valley, yet joined them in the wilderness. An Eagle Scout one day, chumming with the mafia the next. He could lead armies but couldn't manage a family. Raging David, weeping David, bloodthirsty, God hungry, 8 wives, 1 God, a man after God's own heart? That God saw him as such gives hope to us all. David's life has little to offer the unstained saint. Straight-A souls find David's story disappointing. The rest of us find it reassuring. We ride the same roller coaster. We alternate between swan dives and belly flops, souffles and burnt toast. In David's good moments, no one was better. In his bad moments, could one be worse? The heart God loved was a checkered one. We have so much to learn from the life of David. We can learn from his successes and we can learn from his failures. And I think to study the life of David is really kind of a tutorial in our relationship with God. Typically, we think of David as the giant slayer. And we need that, don't we? I don't know what intimidating giants you face in your life, but I know everybody has probably at least one. It could be a person. It could be a lawsuit. It could be unemployment. It could be a disaster. It could be depression. It could be discouragement. It could be a past you can't shake. It could be a future you can't face. It could be a fear that's lurking around the corner. It's robbing you of your joy and stealing you of your faith. Or maybe you can't really even articulate what that giant is. It's just this general malaise that kind of hovers over your heart and settles in over your soul. And you don't know how to deal with that. Or maybe it's a Goliath, a giant much like Goliath, told about in 1 Samuel chapter 17. In fact, I encourage you to go read 1 Samuel 17 this week. It's an amazing page-turning story. But to really understand this story of Goliath, you've got to know the history. Because 300 years before David and Goliath square off against each other, Goliath's ancestors also square off against David's ancestors. Do you remember? Joshua goes into the promised land, and he defeats all the enemies of Israel, including the Philistines, but he leaves living the residents of three cities, Gaza, Gath, and Ashdod. And do you know where Goliath was from? He was from Gath. And the people of Gath, the Philistines from Gath, were like ancient terrorists, like the ISIS people we read about today. And they would terrorize people around them, and for whatever reason, the people of Gath are left standing. And so now, 300 years later, after all this bloodshed, after all of this violence, now the descendants square off. And I think that's one of the reasons why the Israelites are so frightened. I think maybe they think to themselves, you know, my dad fought against his dad. My grandfather fought against his grandfather. And that's one of the things that strikes terror in their hearts. Well, it was a day just like any other day, or so it seemed. And Goliath wakes up and he stretches and he yawns and he takes his huge legs and places them over the side of the bed and he puts on his underwear. And his underwear is a coat of mail. It's bronze armor. First, it's sheets of leather overlaid with stretches and sheets of bronze. It looks like fish scales fastened to his underwear. And his underwear alone probably weighed about 150 pounds. And after he gets his underwear on, he lumbers into the breakfast table where he eats a breakfast of 10 penny nails. And then he puts on the rest of his clothes. He has bronze leggings and a bronze helmet. And he has a spear, the tip of which is bronze. And that tip of the spear weighs 25 pounds. But he is so strong, he's such a behemoth, he can twirl it like a cheerleader twirling her baton. He doesn't bother to shave because he's got more important things to do. His job is to be an intimidator. And he is really good at it because he is 9 feet tall. I mean, he towers over even NBA players today. He would make Shaq look like a shrimp. That's how big he is. And so he goes out one morning, as he did every day for 40 days, to issue his challenge in the Valley of Elah. This is where the battle is pitched. And I want us, you know, you've heard of battle reenactments. We're going to just briefly reenact a little bit of the battle this morning. We're going to pretend that this is the Valley of Elah right here. It was not a narrow ravine. It was a vast canyon, probably about a mile wide, with a slope about a half a mile up this direction, another half mile on this side of the valley. And the Philistines are over here on the north. Sorry, you guys have to be the Philistines. And the Israelites are over here on the south. Now, I want everybody to stand up, if you would, right now. Everybody stand up. And we're going to pretend you guys are the Philistines. I want you to face this way. Turn and face everybody this way. And now you Israelites over here, you're kind of outnumbered today, but I want you to face the Philistines over here. And I want us to imagine that we are engaged in battle and we are issuing our war cries, okay? And in just a minute, on the count of three, I want you to really be sinister, really be, you know, rah, okay? You ready? One, two, three, rah! All right, you do well when you go to a football game. Even better than that, so let's do it one more time. One, two, three, rah! All right, good job. You can be seated. Now, that's often the way armies squared off in the Old Testament. Sometimes, one army would choose its champion, and that champion would square off with the champion from the other army. And that's what happens here in 1 Samuel 17. Goliath goes down every morning and every night, and he spits this challenge through his teeth. And he says to the army of the Israelites, I want you to send a man to fight me. And if he wins, we will be your subjects. If I win, you will be our subjects. And I want you to send somebody. I defy the armies of Israel to go into battle. And he does this every morning and every night, which is the way our giants come into our lives, isn't it? They don't come just once. Repeatedly, day after day, giants of worry and fear and lust and jealousy and pride, they come to us and they melt our hearts. Well, 10 miles away, on the same morning, David wakes up. And David is a handsome teenager, probably about 17, but he's the runt in a family of 8 boys. He jumps into his clothes, he rushes to the breakfast table, and after breakfast, his father Jesse says, "David, I've got an errand for you to run." Because David's 3 oldest brothers are already camped with the Israelites, and they need provisions. And so Jesse says to his son, "I'm going to give you 10 loaves of bread and 10 cheeses, and I want you to take these to the battlefield." And so David takes the provisions. He goes to the battlefield, and when he gets there, he sees the armies lined up, but then he can't believe what he sees. Because Goliath comes out, and he issues this challenge, and David he's embarrassed for God. Now, remember, the Israelites have heard this challenge every day for 40 days and 40 nights, but this is the first time David has heard this. And he's saying, how can this uncircumcised Philistine treat the armies of God and treat God in this way, this insolence? How can this be done? And he feels that the name of God is being disgraced. He wants the name of God to be honored and vindicated. And then he says, now what's going to happen? What's going to be done for the man who conquers this giant? And they say, well, the king promised his daughter's hand in marriage. He promised great wealth. He promised exemption from taxes for his family. But those are not the things with which David is concerned. He's primarily concerned about restoring the honor of the name of God. And so he's ready to go in and just dispense with this dwarf, Goliath. But not so fast, say his brothers, because they are there and they say, you know, this isn't appropriate. And to really appreciate this, you've got to do the backstory. Go all the way back to 1 Samuel 16, when David is anointed as the future king of Israel. Saul was the king. He was rejected as king because of his disobedience to God. And now in 1 Samuel 16, years before he actually ascends to the throne, David is anointed by Samuel. And Samuel comes to the house of Jesse, and Jesse trots out his sons. The first is Eliab. Eliab is tall and dark and handsome. He's the biggest, he's the strongest of all the 8 boys. And Samuel figures, well, it's got to be Eliab. But 1 Samuel 16, verse 7 says something really fascinating. The Lord does not see things as man sees them, for man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. He looks on the heart. So first there's Eliab, and then there's Abinadab, and then there's Shema, and just go through the list, and then there's little David. And God says, this is my choice. Because God looks on the heart. See, there's only one thing that will qualify you as a person after God's own heart, and that's your heart, if you chase after God's heart. Athleticism won't do it. Talent and brains won't do it. Beauty and brilliance won't do it. Nothing wrong with those things. But the only thing that ever qualifies you as a person after God's heart is if you're chasing after His. And aren't you glad? Aren't you thankful that God doesn't measure us by our waist or our wealth or our giftedness? It's just your heart. See, God is the one who supplies and resupplies your heart. His heart ought to be the pacemaker that guides the rhythms of your heart. And the real question is, do you have a heart that's chasing after God's heart? But Eliab is not God's choice. David is God's choice. And I think Eliab finds that it just sticks in his craw. Because he would have been the one who would have been king. And now David's going to be the one. Maybe he thinks to himself, you know, David's here just to upstage Saul. David is here to get a ringside seat at this bloody battle. And he says to David, who's taking care of those scrawny sheep? You ought to be out there taking care of those sheep. And David just brushes him off. He says, well, who are you? Why would you dismiss my question? Can I even talk? And then Saul, the king, gets word that David is ready to go into battle. And Saul is the one who would be king, who should be king, who was the king, and he was the one who should have gone into battle because he stood taller and had broader shoulders than all of the other Israelite soldiers. But at this point, he's just like a cowering schoolboy. His heart is like the heart of a munchkin. And he's glad to have David volunteer, but he says, David, there's no way in the world you can do this. You're just a wet behind the ears punk kid. You can't do this. I mean, you'd be squaring off against General Patton. It'd be the ultimate mismatch. And David says, that's no big deal to me. I mean, I've faced bigger giants than that. One day I was out taking care of my sheep, and a lion had the audacity to take one of my sheep in its mouth, and I just went over and grabbed that lion by the mane and just punched him out. I just pummeled him to death. I've done the same thing with a bear. And I didn't do it in my own power. It wasn't by my prowess or my strength. It was in the power of God. And the same God who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the bear is going to deliver me from this Philistine. And so Saul finally says, okay, have it your way. Go in the name of the Lord. And then Saul does something that he thought was the right thing to do, but it was not a good thing to do. He was well-intentioned, but not very wise. He says, David, you need my armor. Now, I want you to think about that. Saul is a 52 long. David is 36 regular, maybe. I mean, imagine me dressing in Charles Barkley's clothes or putting on a suit that LeBron James owns. I mean, David is like a turtle looking out underneath all this metal. And he knows he can't do this. He can't even move. And it must have been difficult for David to reject Saul's armor because he loved Saul. He was loyal to Saul, but he knew he could not do this battle in Saul's armor. So he just discards it all. You ever try to wear Saul's armor? You ever try to go into battle with armor that's not right for you? It's artificial to you. It's good for you to emulate somebody else's character who's a godly person. But, you know, sometimes we make the mistake of thinking, oh, well, I'll try to do it his way, and it's not the way in which God has blessed you. There are things that you can do for God that nobody else on this planet can do. There are ways in which God has gifted you in which he's blessed nobody else. But you'll make a mistake if you try to wear Saul's armor. Because if you do that, you're acting in a way that's not consistent with God's specific design for you. But the time has come for the battle. Finally arrived. And the stakes could not be higher. This is not just a clash between two armies. It's not just a showdown between two nations. It is a showdown between two gods, effectively. And the people of Israel desperately need a victory because they're in danger of becoming nobodies. And so David goes down to the stream bed that ran right down through the middle of the canyon, and he got down on his knees, and he got his shepherd's pouch, and he starts picking up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 smooth stones. And I think he's probably praying because he spent a lot of time in prayer. He's praying there on his knees, and then he gets up. And Goliath is standing right about there, and David is right about there, and Goliath is insulted. And he says, am I a dog that you come at me with sticks? You could at least send a worthy opponent. Don't send a boy to do a man's job. And Goliath starts coaxing David, come a little bit closer. A little closer. And then Goliath says, I'm going to chop you into birdseed. I'm going to make mincemeat out of you. I'm going to serve you to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. I'm going to make roadkill out of you. How dare you send this apple-faced, peach-fuzzed kid out here to do battle with me? He's just belching hostility all over David. But it's nothing but bombastic threats. Because David says, hey, I'm not intimidated by that. You come at me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord God Almighty, and this day he will deliver you and your army into our hands. I'm going to make birdseed out of you. I'm going to chop you into little pieces, and I'm going to serve you to the crows and the coyotes. And so the challenge has been issued. Goliath stands there. He's waiting for David to come. David takes one of those smooth stones, he puts it in the hollow of his sling, and then he swishes that sling two or three or four times, and he just lets that thing fly. And the stone flies like a bullet, and it hits Goliath right here. Creates a crater in his forehead. And in my mind's eye, I imagine him just doing a face plant. He just falls down right there. And David races out, and he pulls the sword from Goliath's scabbard, and he just slices his head off, and then he picks the head up, and he holds it up. And now it's time for all the Philistine armies to run. I mean, they run like scared chickens. They're chased by the Israelites all the way to the gates of Ekron. And David takes Goliath's head back to the city of Jerusalem as if to say, this is the trophy on my wall. This is what will happen to anybody who interferes with the Lord our God. And he takes the sword and the spear of Goliath also back to Jerusalem as a monument to his victory. Eugene Peterson says, David entered the valley that day not with a Goliath-dominated imagination, but a God-dominated imagination. That he was the only one who was really in touch with reality that day. And reality, most of the time, consists of what we can't see. See, the other soldiers thought of Goliath as this behemoth, this titan who couldn't be beaten. David realizes he's just a matchstick. He's just a toothpick before God. Just a pint-sized braggart. Now, I want you to think about the giants in your life. And I want you to think about how you're approaching those giants. Don't cower in fear. Don't duck behind a desk of work. You know what God wants you to do in the face of your giants? He wants you to rush those giants in the name of the Lord. Maybe the giant that you're squaring off against today is divorce. And God is saying, I want you to rush that giant with a fury, and I want you to call upon the power and the name of the Lord, and I want you to say, I will not allow, God being my helper, I will not allow that giant to destroy my family. Or maybe your giant is some form of addiction. And God is saying, I want you not to cower in fear, I want you to race toward that giant. Ask for the power of the name of the Lord to be with you. Get with a recovery group. Get with people who will encourage you. But make sure you rush that giant. Or maybe it's discouragement, or it's depression, or it's fear, or it's selfishness. And God says, don't allow yourself to be intimidated by any giant. You rush that giant. You don't have to be brilliant or beautiful. You don't have to be eloquent. You just have to trust in the name of the Lord and call upon his name. I wonder what God thinks when we shrink in fear. I wonder what God thinks when we wring our hands when he has promised to deliver the enemy into our hands. You know, it's so fascinating to me when you look at the life of David. Every time he trusted God, giants fell. Every time he refused to trust God, he fell. And it's fascinating to me to see in the words of 1 Samuel 17 how many times David refers to God. Nobody else refers to God. The soldiers don't do it. His brothers don't do it. But listen to these verses from 1 Samuel 17 that describe David's reference to God. Verse 37. The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. Verse 45, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Notice David's reference to armies, plural. Wasn't there just one army of Israel? Not in David's mind. He envisions entire platoons being sent out by God. Angelic armies multiplied in the name of God. Verse 46, this day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. Or verse 47, all those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, but the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. David refers to God 9 times. He refers to Goliath 2 times. What's the ratio like in your life? When you're facing off against your giant, do you talk more about God, or do you talk more about the giant? When you're contemplating and you're thinking about that giant of opposition in your life, is your mind more dominated by the giant, or is it more dominated by God? You know, it's fascinating to me that there are no miracles in this story. God doesn't send a great blast of wind to blow Goliath down. He doesn't drown the Philistines like he had drowned the Pharaoh's chariots and armies. But David knows that when you invoke the name of the Lord and you trust in the strength of the Lord, you release the power of the Lord. When you trust in the name of the Lord and you invoke the name of the Lord and you trust the strength of the Lord, you release the power of the Lord. So what giant are you facing today? It doesn't matter what the giant is, the battle is the Lord's. The battle is the Lord's. Loneliness can't defeat you because the battle is the Lord's. Bullying can't defeat you because the battle is the Lord's. Disability can't defeat you because the battle is the Lord's. Not even death can defeat you because the battle is the Lord's. It's His. You know, Jesus faced severe opposition when he went to the cross. He stared right into the face of enemy opposition. He went mano a mano with Satan, and Satan did his best to shout Jesus down, but Jesus refused to give in because he knew that the battle is the Lord's. And when you and I look at the cross, we can know that there is no enemy that is any match for God. And we can know if God is for you, who could be against you? Let's bow and pray.